if you're interviewing financial planners, in addition to credentials, in addition to are you a fiduciary, next question I'd be is, how do you make money? Do you make money off the investments you put me in? That doesn't mean they're bad people necessarily. I work with many people in this industry that work for a lot of other firms that's part of their business model, but it's just important that you as the consumer, you as the recipient of their advice, understand what you're getting yourself into.
Welcome to Passive Income Pilots, where pilots upgrade their money. This is the definitive source for personal finance and investment tactics for aviators. We interview world-renowned experts and share these lessons with the flying community. So if you're ready for practical knowledge and insights, let's roll.
Hey, welcome back to Passive Income Pilots, everyone. I'm your host, Tait Durier, here with my wonderful co-host, Ryan Gibson. What's going on, man?
Not too much, Tait. Good to be back. And good to have some great weather here in Seattle to kick the summer off about a month earlier than last year. So I'm feeling good.
Well, now that it's not freezing and raining, I might have to come up there and we can do some in person in the studio.
Hey, let's fly somewhere. Let's take the Cirrus somewhere and we'll go somewhere fun like the San Juan Islands like I did last weekend, which was a blast.
That sounds amazing. Let's do it. So today we have Jesse Reed, who is a former Top Gun F-18 pilot, also transitioned to the airlines and now works in financial strategy. Ryan, this is somebody who you've known for a while. You want to sort of tee Jesse up here?
Yeah. So, you know those experiences you have at the airlines, if you're an airline pilot and you go through training with somebody and they're just absolute rock stars, like all the way around five stars, like they're killing it in the sim. They're super fun to hang out with after, and they can become your lifelong friends. Well, that's Jesse. And I'm really excited that he's on the show. He's in the financial services industry. Obviously, he's helping other pilots plan out their lives. And we're going to kind of get into that. And he's also got a great, interesting story about being in Top Gun. And he's going to demystify some of the things in the movie that maybe aren't really all that true. So sorry to burst your bubble if you're a Top Gun fan like I am. So
I love it. Let's get right into it. Jesse Reed.
Well, welcome back to the show. I have my good friend and fellow aviator that I did some training with in the 7576 with us today, Jesse Reed. But Tait, how's it going?
It's great. Jesse, thank you so much for jumping on with us, man. Appreciate you being here.
It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure. And I've seen the list of guests you've had up to this point. I haven't written any books or anything like that, like so many of them. So I'm honored to be here with you guys. And Ryan, it's good to see you again, buddy.
Yeah. And you have such a particularly interesting story, the perfect kind of story we love to share with our listeners in regards to being a military pilot. Thank you for your service, flying F-18s, being in Top Gun, and then making a move to the airlines and then having a great financial background and a financial story. So we're really kind of just excited to jump in and talk about your service and some things that you learned and have experienced along the way. So why don't you go ahead and kick us off?
Yeah, absolutely. And I, like you said, I'm definitely your guy that was in the airlines that had a plan B, and thank goodness I did. So I'm one of these born to fly kids, probably like a lot of people that are listening to this are. I mean, if you look at all the pictures of me as a kid, it's standing there with an airplane. So I definitely had a vision as a kid that I wanted to be up in the sky somehow. And, you know, long story short, I ended up in the Navy, graduated from the Naval Academy in 2002. With a degree in political science, poli-sci and fly, as they say at the Naval Academy.
Nice.
Yeah. And did pretty well in flight school. I started off in the Air Force side of it through a little joint program they had. So I started flying T-37 Tweets at Advanced Air Force Base down in Enid, Oklahoma. Did pretty well there. Went on to Meridian, Mississippi, where I trained in the T-45, which is the primary tactical trainer for the Navy. And that's where you do your first time doing a carrier landing and get your first look behind the boat as a Navy pilot. Selected F-18s out of there and then flew F-18s for most of my career. There was a little stint at a little place you guys might have heard of, Top Gun, in the middle there. Yeah. As part of my career. So I'll certainly talk about that. And then after I did my payback tour after Top Gun, ended up in the financial world and the airlines after that. Yeah, we can break that down piece by piece if you'd like.
Yeah, you pretty much live in every single boy's dream and girl's dream that wants to be an aviator. I mean, that's pretty cool. I mean, can we just get into that? I mean, that's
it's crazy, man.
Yeah, Maverick, airing, and it's just an awesome movie. And the visuals and all that stuff. So yeah, let's get into that.
It was really fun to see that happen. And I kind of pinch myself sometimes because, I mean, I think it was 1986. I'm a 5 or 6 year old kid sitting in the movie theater watching that movie. And just, I think that's my earliest memory of anything is watching that movie on the big screen and thinking, well, I'm going to do that. And so for years, I eventually kind of shut up about it in school, but I used to go around telling people, hey, I'm going to fly planes in the Navy someday. And of course, you know, kids are mean in grade school and all that. And they would just laugh me out of the room. And so I kind of stopped saying that, but that was my vision. And then to years later in 2009, so I'm progressing through my career here, and to be told, I get a letter from the Navy that says, congratulations, you've been accepted to the Navy Fighter Weapons School, AKA Top Gun. And to just kind of pinch myself and go, holy moly, I can't believe this all started with me watching that movie. As campy and as crazy and unrealistic as it is, it's still a fantastic inspiration. No, I can't quote the movie in this. If the bros find out that I quote the movie, I owe a fine even to this day. I've heard stories of people getting a Venmo request for $20 if you quote the movie.
That's amazing.
Oh, that's good.
Well, tell us about it. I think even people that have flown F-18s, you know, haven't been to Top Gun, they probably know more about it than all of us. But for us airline guys and gals who have never had the opportunity to serve, tell us about it. What's the actual experience like in real life?
Well, first of all, no beach volleyball.
No group showers.
You've got to wear cutoff jeans. Yes. If you do any of that stuff. So that's the qualifier. No, actually, you know, people ask me, hey, how was it in San Diego? And I remind them that, hey, actually in the mid-90s, the original location of Top Gun, where it all started back in the day and where that first movie was filmed, was moved from Miramar, California out to the desert of Fallon, Nevada. Totally makes sense from a training perspective. And needs of the Navy perspective, the training ranges are out there are fantastic. It's where the second more recent movie was filmed. But from a quality of life and sort of things to do perspective for a pilot, it's really nothing going on in that town. It literally is just out in the middle of nowhere, about 80 miles east of Reno, and is a small little town. So the San Diego beach volleyball days aren't even an option, even if you wanted to. Yeah, you know, I get a lot of questions about that. When the movie came out last year, I'm involved in some charities here in the Kansas City area that have to do with veterans organizations. And I suddenly found myself, normally I'm a pretty discreet person, found myself wearing a flight suit again and talking to crowds of people here in Kansas City and schools and things like that to educate them on what Top Gun is really like. And what the actual background is behind it. I hate to disappoint the people that are fans of the movie and listening, but it's much more studious than the movies make it out to be. A lot of time spent briefing, debriefing, actually very little time spent flying in the air compared to the other things you do at Top Gun. So that's the thing that I think is usually surprising to most people. But what they're trying to do there is make you a teacher. And it's interesting, that experience more than anything in aviation has helped me in my current job in the finance world, because I do a lot of education and teaching, and I kind of bring that heart of a teacher to what I do here. I always hated in aviation when somebody would tell you to do something, they wouldn't tell you the why behind it. They just go, press the I believe button, as we say as pilots, and just do it. And I always wanted to know why. And so I think that was one of the big things that applicable skills that I think I carry with me to this day from the Top Gun experience. God knows if I got an F-18 today, I'm years out of the cockpit. My beard's getting gray here now. I don't think I could go fight a jet like I used to.
But, well, Maverick did. He just picked right up in the right. It's been a minute.
You know, it's amazing. Minute, right? That guy's 20 years older than me, and probably can jump higher than me and run faster than me. I need to get on the Scientology program. I think.
Well, I mean, do you guys? But what about dogfight football? I mean, they played that in Maverick. You guys didn't play dogfight football, offense and defense. That looks like fun.
Dogfight football, I think, with actual Type A fighter pilots would have turned into fist fight football pretty quickly.
I bet it would.
and especially because there probably would have been a lot of beer involved as well.
That's excellent.
Well, that's great. Well,
what about your transition from the military into the airlines?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So, you know, as I as I, so I finished up my Top Gun instruction tour, and there's a variety of different ways you can instruct a Top Gun. You can stay up there at the schoolhouse and teach the incoming Top Gun classes, or you can go out and teach the fleet aviators that are out of there. I chose to do the latter and actually go teach the fleet aviators. So it was kind of interesting part of my experience doing that. I'd be talking in some cases and working with a brand new, you know, snot-nosed kid straight out of flight school, and work with him all the way up to admirals or captains that were returning from some Pentagon desk job in the fleet. And it was really fun to kind of teach all the different aspects of that. Ryan, probably kind of similar to going back to training with like a, you know, one of those old dog captains, right? And So kind of had a real variety of experience in my instruction tour. After that, you owe the Navy about a two-year tour that's called your training officer tour. For folks listening, when you watch the new Top Gun Maverick movie and they bring all those Top Gun folks back in the movie, they don't really say it in the movie, but those are essentially people that are in their training officer tour, which is your payback tour. That's where you go to another operational squadron, so you're no longer in shore duty, you're no longer in an instructional capacity. But you go to the squadron and you're the resident Top Gun expert that's entrusted with making sure that your air crew, all your squadron mates, are up to speed on the current Top Gun standardization, which is basically the correct way to do things, if you will. Make sure that they're following the tactical recommendations for so you can have the best chance of success. But that was my final active duty tour in the Navy. During that time, I started doing like everyone else who was kind of making an exit plan from the military. I went and got my ATP. I'm kind of glad I did it when I did, because I think the standards have gotten more rigorous since then. I was one of those like 2-day wonders that took the gouge test. I think I knocked my written test out in about 25 minutes, maybe less, and then got my ATP out in Arizona. But I held off, and this is going to be a segue into my plan B and some of the personal stuff that affected me, and I think might affect a lot of your listeners out there, because let's face it, when you travel for a living, you don't have a normal 9-to-5 job. It can cause chaos in your family life. It can cause some unpredictable things to happen. And I was starting to see a little bit of that in my life. At that point, I was married. So my first marriage, like so many airline pilots, have more than one under their belt. I was on my first. I had a couple kids. And we'll just say, I'll kind of keep it top level here, but noticing some things in the house with my former spouse that were kind of red flags that made me feel like maybe I shouldn't be traveling long term. So even though I had my ATP, didn't feel like going in the airlines was probably a great move for me to be gone, you know, for multiple weeks at a time or multiple weeks out of a month. So just through happenstance, met somebody in the investment industry, a wholesaler for a mutual fund in the Seattle area. When I got off active duty, I was living kind of in Ryan's neck of the woods there in King County, and was still a reservist up at Whidbey Island. Got me an interview with a major broker-dealer investment advisory firm in the country. I guarantee everybody's heard the name. I'll save everyone the actual name here, but went and interviewed with them. And me, who's got a poli-sci background, I've been flying airplanes my whole career. My only experience with finance up to that point had been my general interest in it, my own personal finances. And basically, I spent 40 minutes in an interview on the top level of the skyscraper in downtown Seattle, looking at the Puget Sound, just going, how do you get anything done here in a day's work with a view like this?
Yeah.
And spent 45 minutes trying to convince the guy not to hire me, because I said, hey, look, I've been flying airplanes my whole life. I got a poli-sci degree that I haven't used in, you know, 15 years. And he said, hey, military guys do great. They learn fast. Pilots learn fast. We actually have pilots that have made transitions to careers here at this company. When can you start? So I was actually kind of surprised that I got hired like that. And so off I was to the races. And almost instantaneously with that event happening in my life, I came home one day from a training debt, and basically the house was cleared out and the kids were gone. It's one of those divorce stories that if you've sat in the cockpit before, for all your listeners, you've probably flown with a first officer or captain that has some similar story where, hey, I came home one day and just, or I got handed papers for a divorce, and just like that, my life changed. So I probably only spent not even a year at this firm. And for reasons that I can get into a little bit later for your listeners here about the different kind of options there are out there. If you're looking for help just generally with planning and all, there's a lot of different things out there, and it makes the industry really confusing to people. And so I ended up leaving that firm and got hired by Delta Airlines because in the meantime, had a lot of stuff going on in my personal life. Did not like the atmosphere, the culture of where I was working, kind of that kind of fraternity sort of culture. A lot of people would think on certain Wall Street and kind of stuff that, in my opinion, gives the financial industry kind of a bad name with people. Did not particularly enjoy that, and was looking for a way to put food on the table in the meantime. And so went and got hired by a major airline, and was off to the races there. Concurrently with getting hired by an airline, I got hired now by a firm that was in the independent space that focused more on planning and less on trying to sell stuff to people. And that's where I really got my foothold in as far as really falling in love with planning and helping out airline pilots. Most of my clients, almost from the get-go, were also in the airline industry. And I just kind of got this big heart for people that are in this industry because it's not normal. It's not normal what we do as pilots. It's not normal whether you're a military pilot, whether you're an airline pilot. You spend so much time on the road. When you come home, your time at home is an absolute premium. You're trying to get stuff done. If you're married, you got a honey-do list that's a mile long when you walk in the door. The kids haven't seen you if you got kids in a while, and it's just difficult. And so I really enjoy being part of somebody's team to help them out with that. And in some cases, to be someone who's been there, done that, when inevitably you run into somebody that's had an experience that's not so great, right? Like maybe financial devastation from a divorce or some other sort of unfortunate thing that's happened to them. So that was a lot of me talking there. It probably elicited some more questions on your guys' part.
No, that's incredible.
Yeah, no. Yeah, great story. And it shows, I think as investors, a relatability to someone's background, I think is a great starting point for trust and experience in doing the right moves in an investment portfolio. And I think you having that experience, not only military, civilian, some personal hardship that kind of led you on this path to your plan B, which is probably what you're called to do, right? Which is, you know, you're a great teacher, very motivated, very detail oriented. It's just fun to see all that kind of come together and be something that you provide a huge value to other people. So, you know, that's part of the reason why Tait and I wanted to do this podcast, was because we wanted to bring these, you know, people like yourself onto the show to kind of talk about, you know, hey, how these things kind of come to a head, and that people like yourself, Jesse, are out there to help people plan through their financial journey. So that's great.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think a few of your guests have turned some of their plan A or plan B's into their plan A's. There's definitely some, I think I told you guys earlier, I've listened to a lot of the guests you had on here so far, and it's really neat to hear their stories too, of how they were involved in aviation and sort of the finance side of their life, whether through their own career or just their own investing habits. Something that was a plan B almost becomes kind of their primary, and the flying becomes now this almost luxury where you get to have as kind of a fun thing that you do.
Yeah,
that becomes your side gig, which kind of really seems like the dream to me.
Yeah,
oh, yeah. Flying B,
absolutely.
Be the side gig and not the primary.
Yeah, I mean, real estate investing is what is allowing me to potentially downgrade and, you know, not chase the big money and, you know, chase the schedule and the lifestyle instead.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And slip the surly bonds on occasion when you got to get out of the house.
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's the thing too. Like, I think a lot of people love flying, and it's not that they don't want to go fly or could do that. I think just people want the more flexibility in their schedule. Maybe that's something that they want. And, you know, having to decide between some overtime or going on a trip, you know, may be overcome by having passive income. And I think that's what's great. But Jesse, can you kind of just outline sort of the, you know, maybe a young pilot's plan for their financial journey that you kind of help them on? Like just a kind of a skeleton of like what you would take them through and sort of where you would poke and, you know, find kind of deficiencies or ways that you can really help them?
Sure, absolutely. I kind of think of my job as, and I teach in parables a lot. I kind of think of like, well, Jesus taught in parables to all the disciples. So, and he did pretty well with that. I think he was considered an okay teacher. So I kind of use a lot of parables with my pilots, right? Or maybe if I'm talking even a non-pilot, I like to talk in analogies, like maybe I'll use a sports analogy for it. But I like to think of my job in the life of a pilot or any of my clients as sort of the captain, if you will, of the operation. And the way I'll describe that role to a pilot when I'm talking to him is I'll ask him, hey, do you know what the flight attendants do on the plane? And they go, of course, yeah, I know what they do. You know what the operations guy who sends in the weight and balance does? Yeah, I know what he does. You know what the gate agent does when they scan the tickets? Yeah. do you think you could do all those jobs? In some cases, you may fly with a guy who says, yeah, I could probably do those too. I go, is it make sense for you to do all those jobs? Well, no, I, you know, we wouldn't be an efficient operation if we did that. So I kind of view myself as the quarterback of this team of all these other specialists. So if I'm the captain, or to use a football analogy, if I'm the quarterback on the team, well, I need a lot of other people on my team that have very specialized roles to help make, you know, to get the plane pushed back, you know, in the airplane analogy from the gate. And I think everybody in this industry, the aviation industry, knows there's a lot of other people that make that happen to get that plane pushed back from the gate and from pushback to block in, essentially. So same idea here, except now we're talking financial planning. So when I'm talking to a young pilot, what I do is I treat it like a flight plan. I flew with this guy once. This is a good story. I flew with this guy once and you know how it is. You get on a trip, you're on day two, maybe of a 3 day or 4 day. We're staring out the window, your arms are crossed, you're looking at the terrain. And now at some point, we've talked about everything else in the world, from girls to vacation houses to where's the best place you've ever been, your favorite restaurant in Boston, et cetera, et cetera.
Dog sniffing dog, is what I call it.
Yeah, and then, there you go. And then obviously we start talking about side gigs, or we start talking about, you know, what else are you involved in? And then money, I don't think I was ever on a trip where money in some form or fashion did not come up. And at the time when I was still flying and doing this, I don't fly anymore. I do this primarily. But at the time when I was still flying and doing advising concurrently, this subject would come up and it would kind of sit with whoever I was flying with. I was always a first officer, so I was always sitting with a captain, and they'd stare out the window and they'd kind of cross their arms and think for a little while. And then inevitably a question would come out like, oh, so how much do I need to retire? Or, you know, what's my magic number? And I usually had a similar response to that, which was, I don't know, how much gas do we need in this jet to take off? And they kind of look at me and go, well, I get it depends, doesn't it? And I go, yeah, you're absolutely right. It depends, right? And so what my job is here is to help people figure out what's the end destination going to be. And we work backwards, just like a flight plan, to get you where you are on deck today, figure out what all the factors are going to play into in your particular life between now here at the point of origin to our destination, what kind of headwinds were we going to encounter, and kind of build it almost like a flight plan working from backwards, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Makes total sense.
Makes a lot.
And of course there's a lot that goes into that. Investments is the sexy thing that everyone loves to talk about in the financial planning world. It's what clients want to talk about. And what I really like about your podcast so far is you've had a lot of guests that are in these other spaces of areas in your life with a dollar sign that aren't just investment related. You had a gentleman, I want to say his name was Clint Coons. Was he on recently, Ryan?
Yep, yep. I was
mowing the lawn listening to that podcast a few weeks ago. And I think my wife was looking out the window. I've since remarried, by the way. And my wife's looking out the window, and I was probably out there like pushing the lawnmower, and I was like nodding my head, and I was going like, amen. He was saying so many great things that have nothing to do really with it. There was a little bit of investment talking there, but talking about estate planning and all that. And I was just like, this guy is rock solid. I love what this guy's saying, because it was pointing out that there's so much more that goes into somebody's financial life than just what's in a portfolio. And that's really important that I educate people on that as well, because you can make all the money in the world, but if you don't have a plan for taxes, if you don't have a plan for efficient transfer of what you own to your future generations, or how you want to gift it, you know, you just give it back to Uncle Sam, which I don't know about you, that usually makes me angry. And I worked for Uncle Sam for a number of years, so I can speak to how inefficient he is.
That's right.
<at times.
laughs> And if you want to go back to that, it's episode 16.
Yep.
I'll just plug that.
With Clint, and he did a great job talking about
with Clint and Anderson at Anderson Advisors.
Yeah, they do a fantastic job just tax and legal planning, and obviously we were appreciative to have them on the show. So yeah, no, good reference back, and good comparison.
So. Yeah.
So Jesse, good. Your firm, Creative Planning, talk us through what that would look like. You know, I mean, we've talked in the hyperbole of, you know, the flight plan. What does that actually look like when you sit down with someone? What sort of factors are you asking questions on? What should people come to that meeting prepared with?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. First things first, I just like to learn about what their life is like, right? Because ultimately what I'm doing is I'm not you know, especially when it comes to the investment side, we're not trying to just invest in a vacuum. We're trying to ultimately do what we all want to do. And the reason we all invest in the long run, because we want to do things, right? We want to live out some certain financial goals in our lives, whether it's, you know, have a comfortable retirement, you know, to live off of passive income and not have to worry about, you know, working as long as maybe I have to. Maybe I don't want to work until I'm 65 years old in the airlines. Maybe I want to hang it up earlier. So just learn a little bit about their family, their situation, and ultimately try to tease out what are your goals? What do you actually want to do? Sometimes I talk to people and they just want to invest and they just want to sock money away and they just want rate of return and they want the most aggressive sort of thing to happen in their mind, but they don't have a why behind it. And so I tell people a lot of times, you know, as financial advisors, we wear this number crunching hat, but more often I have this psychologist hat that I put on instead of the number crunching hat, because if somebody doesn't have a why behind what they're trying to do, I'm not afraid to tell them, hey, we might not be the right person for you to work with here. So part of that first meeting and introduction to somebody who's interested in working with our airline team here at Creative Planning is to figure out your why. What are your goals? From there, we go through a very intensive planning process. We walk them through a series of meetings to take that why that they told me when I first met them and start to put together a plan of action for them to achieve that why. What that might look like for someone here is in a first meeting, we'll create an actual financial plan, that sort of backwards working flight plan that I described earlier, where we assign dollar amounts to all these different goals in their lives. And you guys know as well as I do, pilots, you know, have a lot of goals outside of just retirement. We have our toys, right? I've talked to a lot of pilots that, hey, I want to have that second house in Destin or Daytona Beach, Florida. I want to buy that airplane and have that hangar. That's got a cost associated with it. And of course, retirement is the number one goal that especially airline pilots, you got to consider at some point if flying is your main thing, because the government and you just physically can't do it compared to other careers where you can maybe work a couple of extra years. If you're an airline pilot for a major airline right now, as it stands, 65 years old, you're out. That's it. So unless you can go get some other gig after that, that's kind of the end of your work career. So we take all those financial plan goals that they tell us, that a client would tell us, assign them dollar values, and we work backwards to where they are now to kind of figure out, okay, what do you have now? What's your savings rate? You know, what is the airline dumping into your 401k in the form of non-elected contributions? Do you have an airline that has some sort of pension benefit? Do you have some sort of benefit from your military career? What other kind of income sources do you have from your passive income portfolio? We have a lot of clients that come here and they own real estate, whether they're doing the slumlord thing, just renting out their old house that they used to have that's now an investment property, or they have multiple properties or ownership in like a syndication, something like that. We apply those income sources to their retirement objective as well as their other objectives and come up with a, hey, here you are today. Here's what you need to do from point A to point B to have a reasonable assurance of success. Typically after that meeting, we'll reconvene, and that's where the subject matter experts on our team, you know, the other members of the flight team that make the flight happen. So in my case, instead of having, you know, gate agents and flight attendants or, you know, an operations guy that's sending numbers, I've got an estate planning attorney on my team. I've got a CPA on my team. I've got folks that are from the life insurance industry, the Medicare industry, all these people that come from these different walks of life out there that were in these separate industries that now work here at Creative Planning to give that specialized advice when I need to call in an expert. So I can speak very intelligently about estate planning, but I'm not an attorney. And so I can't draft you documents. I can't do those things. I can't take it that next step. When I have a client that needs that next step taken, then I bring the estate planning attorney in to execute that part of the plan. Or if I have a great example, we have clients all the time that are United clients. And for all the United folks out there listening, you probably know pretty well that your life insurance offered by your company is not real great, say compared to like a Delta Airlines pilot that gets quite a bit of group insurance that's available to you. So a common problem I'm helping United pilots solve is, how do we fix that insurance shortfall? What are some options for you out there? Because if you're the primary breadwinner in your family and suddenly you're gone last week, what's your wife and kids going to do if you're just relying on that United benefit? So those are some examples of not only the financial planning process that's just common here to Creative Planning, but some of that airline touch that our team brings in here, because we have a very intimate knowledge of the different benefit plans of all the different airlines out there.
That's incredible. That's something really unique, I think, because most, you know, you usually have to run a lot of errands to find all those things. So it's nice to find it all in one shop where you can put all the pieces together.
That was the genesis. You're absolutely right, Tait. That was the genesis of this company. Years ago, when Peter Maluk bought this company, I don't know if your listeners are familiar with that name. He's our CEO, but it was just an estate planning firm with, I think, maybe five or six people that worked here, and he bought it, you know, decades ago, and saw that same problem. Saw the problem that, hey, I've got estate planning clients that need me to talk to their CPA, so I got to go across town and deliver documents to them and try to get on the phone with them. I've got clients that have an investment advisor that's doing their portfolio stuff. I got to talk to them. And so his vision really very quickly became, you know, we should have one place for people to just get all that. And I don't know if you've seen it in your guys's particular walks of life there in finance, but you know, sometimes you can all be on the same team. I kind of compare it to the CIA and the FBI. We're all on the same team, but sometimes everyone's still kind of holding their cards close to their chest. What I really enjoy about the team atmosphere here at Creative Planning is we don't do that. We share information with our clients. So it's not hard to get that information you need to better help them out.
I know Ryan's dying to jump in here, but I want to unpack something real quick. What's the difference between a financial planner and a financial advisor?
You asked a great question, and this is delving into what I think, this is Jesse Reed's opinion now, but probably the opinion of a lot of people. It's what the problem is in this industry, which is you can call yourself a financial planner and have zero experience practically, and other than maybe taking a quick designation exam, call yourself a financial planner. And it really is a travesty. It's a disservice to the folks out there that legitimately need help. And so that is a discussion too. That's a question I get asked a lot. It's a similar question too, is people will ask me, are you fiduciary? Well, you know what? Everyone these days calls themselves a fiduciary, but I think there's different levels of fiduciary as well, because as with all things, all regulations, people kind of figure out out there in the corporate world ways to sort of scurry around the issue and still call themselves a certain thing when they're really not. A lot of financial planners out there are really salespeople in disguise. A lot of fiduciaries out there have a lot of conflicts of interest that they can disclose to you in a lengthy client agreement that's got 20 pages in it that they know people aren't going to really read, and they've done their fiduciary duty by doing that. And so there's a lot of that out there. And whenever I talk to somebody, I highly encourage them to, whether they're talking to me and talking to other people, read those fine details, ask those questions that you just asked, Tait, right? For folks out there, whether they would want to work with Creative Planning or any company in the world out there, these are the kinds of questions you want to ask. What are your qualifications? What do you bring to the table as far as planning that makes me that I should consider you over someone else?
And what's the difference between a financial advisor then? So, or someone that, how does somebody identify someone with a great resume?
Sure. A financial planner advisor, those are kind of just interchangeable terms. You know, what we tell people, and this is why we hire folks that are very credentialed here at Creative Planning. Again, this isn't meant to be a plug for Creative Planning, but just to say that,
of course,
we take that very seriously.
And it's unfortunate that those two things sound so similar, right?
They do. Yeah, exactly. That's part of the education piece here. I liken it to, and so if you're a certified financial planner out there, I kind of think of it as like holding on to your license as a pilot, right? You know, the company may put you in a position to jeopardize your license as a pilot. And so it's up to you to maintain, you know, yourself within scheduling regulations, FAA regulations, all the things that could happen that could cause you to have the FAA start poking around. CFPs have that same responsibility. So you could go work for a company as a CFP. And if you're working for a company that, we'll just say, you know, maybe has some shady practices, you're putting your own credentials on the line. So you'll typically... What I tell people is, whether you work with me or you work with some other company, I highly encourage you to look at the credentials of the people that you're working with, because that does mean something.
What exactly should they be looking for?
Well, I'm going to give you again what I think they should be looking for.
Yeah, of course. It can be an opinion.
Yeah. If I'm going to give a recommendation for someone out there to go get a financial planner, someone to help them out with their overall holistic financial situation, you're going to want to work with a fiduciary. the fiduciary standard means they put your best interest first. Now, I just said a second ago that there's a lot of people that kind of wiggle around that fiduciary. So you want to follow up. Fiduciary should kind of be the first question you ask. The second question is, okay, how do you get compensated, and what kind of conflicts of interest should I be aware of? And if you outright ask that question to somebody, they owe you an answer. The way that we deal with that here is we remove the conflicts of interest here at Creative Planning. So we don't sell anything here. You will find there's a lot of CFPs out there. There's a lot of fiduciaries out there. There's a lot of firms out there in the planning business that make money off of what they put in your portfolio. And it's not always incredibly transparent to people for that. So that is how we approach it here. We really try to make ourselves a fiduciary in the truest sense, and that, hey, it doesn't matter to me from my bottom line, me putting food on my table, what kind of investments you have in your portfolio, because I don't make money off those. I'm going to do what I think's in your best interest and recommend to you what I think's in your best interest. And it doesn't matter to me if it's this kind of fund or that kind of fund necessarily. It matters to me that it's working for you in your best interest. And so that is a thing that I would encourage people to ask as well. If you're interviewing financial planners, in addition to credentials, in addition to, are you a fiduciary? Next question I'd be is, how do you make money? Do you make money off the investments you put me in? That doesn't mean they're bad people necessarily. I work with many people in this industry that work for a lot of other firms that's part of their business model, but it's just important that you as the consumer, you as the recipient of their advice, understand what you're getting yourself into.
I love it. Well, that's information that we can use. So that's what we're always trying to get to on the show, right? Is how can we better understand this and be better equipped when we're out there in the marketplace?
I have a question for you guys. So obviously you both are involved in finance and primarily in the real estate. What do you feel like your actual understanding is? Do you feel like even folks in the financial industry have sort of a lack of knowledge in this area? And it's an honest, curiosity question.
Yeah, I love this conversation. Yes. I love this. This is great. Thank you for asking that question. That's a great question.
Big time. Ryan, I'll let you take that.
Yeah, so I think that good financial advisors, planners, whatever you want to call the distinction, doesn't matter. Anybody who's helping anybody put together a comprehensive plan, yeah, I think to your point, should understand the individual's goals, objectives, and kind of where they sit on everything. So I think that's important. And then I think as you scale net worth and as you scale risk tolerance or transition into wealth preservation, I think that the understanding of having, you know, hard assets like real estate comprise some of your allocation is really important. And I think savvy financial planners, advisors, whatever, who understand that are valuable, because if you think about like the 60-40, you know, adage, right? You know, 60% stock, 40% bonds, like that's bonds. Like even the most institutional savvy investors know that is a dead like strategy. I mean, it's a good strategy. It's not a dead strategy. I shouldn't say it's a dead strategy, but it's
pretty dead.
It had a bad year last year. We'll put it that way.
Yeah. But you know, it's kind of like people listen to this show or listen to other podcasts or hear about these syndications or real estate allocations. And it's like, they're hearing about it for the first time and they're like skeptical. Right. And it's
sure.
This has been going on for 100 years. I mean, people invest in hard assets. I think what's different now is that the availability has become more widespread. And there's been more allocation to this space, especially in light of, you know, earning out 20-30% annual returns over the past, you know, 5-10 years. And people are going, wow, this is pretty cool. And I think a good financial strategist will help that investor understand that you really have to be a good investor to have a good investor mindset to understand what you're doing, because these are illiquid investments. They have a great hedge against inflation. They don't move very fast. The market moves very fast, right? When you have a stock that moves up and down, it's moving very fast. But real estate, I mean, I'll never forget COVID hit. And it's like COVID hit and the stock market cratered a little bit when COVID onset of the pandemic, when no one really knew what was going on. But none of my properties lost much occupancy, if at all, right? Yeah. So there was no real immediate impact. There was no kind of ebb and flow. So having these types of hard assets in a portfolio should make up a composition. And I think a good financial advisor or planner or strategist or whatever their title is understands that is the allocation, but also can educate their clients as to the risks of those investments. So
Yeah, and we would agree here that real estate is an absolutely vital part of a portfolio. And we get into this term that I have heard in your podcast in the past, for those that maybe haven't heard it in some of the previous episodes. I'm trying to remember the gentleman who talked about it, but talked about uncorrelated assets, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, you guys would probably agree with me that if all your real estate assets were tied up in the exact same thing and you had a huge portion of your net worth tied up in one single part of the real estate market, that probably wouldn't be the wisest thing to do in the world. So uncorrelation, meaning, for those that are listening out there, meaning that the performance or the movement of one particular asset in your portfolio is uncorrelated to the movement of another. So Ryan, you're talking like what the stock market did during COVID, right? Took a, you know, the stock market's kind of like a roller coaster during COVID, right? Up and down in the short term, you know, and real estate didn't move as quickly. Those are two uncorrelated assets in this case, right? Meaning that, hey, they're not relying on each other. Whereas, you know, if you take one S&P, to use a very simplistic example that I use a lot when I'm talking tax loss harvesting, for instance, with clients, is I'll say, hey, if I have an S&P 500 ETF from this one company and a large cap ETF from this other company, doesn't matter which one's in your portfolio, they're equally correlated. They're going to move exactly the same. If you look at a graph of them, you know, over time, it's going to look like they're flying formation off each other of the two graphs. They'll basically be superimposed over each other. So I think that's a really key concept when it comes to your portfolios, whether it's heavy on real estate, lighter on real estate, heavy on stocks, heavy on whatever, that you have diversification built in there. You got to have that uncorrelation between assets. You can't put all your eggs necessarily in just one basket. So that's a great point, Ryan.
Yeah, and I love that you asked that question, because so often, like I have a financial planner or whatever the title was.
It's confusing. It's confusing.
I know,
it's
very confusing. And like I brought up the fact that like, hey, I want to have real estate in my portfolio, and I didn't really get a great response. Like, you know,
sure,
I can't. And so like when I hear that stuff, I get turned off, because it's like, okay, you just want me to do what you want to do, which is the things that you're going to fee and get income off of, or worse, you don't really understand what's out there and you don't have this wide breadth of knowledge of where to go invest.
Yeah.
And so when I hear that, I'm like, oh yeah, you know, I don't really do that, or that's risky, or
sure.
You know, it's like, no, like big money and smart money is doing it. So give me a path, like connect me with operators that have good deals that have track record and trust and things like that, that I can go invest with. Absolutely. And that's what a lot of really these niche shops like Creative Planning like have. And I think,
can I give you an example of kind of what you're talking about there, Ryan, with actually somebody, and this is a real life example of an airline pilot that has quite a bit in his 401k, has quite a bit in a taxable account, and owns several real estate properties in a ski resort town, Park City, Utah. And is kind of getting tired of having those properties. he likes the real estate. He likes the appreciation of it, the values of that real estate have gone up. It's provided decent income, especially in the ski season in this town. What he's gotten tired of is the stuff that you guys kind of help people out with, which is the headache that comes along with owning real estate, investment real estate. Yep. In his case, you know, he gets a bunch of ski bums that come in there and get high and get drunk and throw up and all that stuff after he rents it out. And he's got to deal with that, right? So he's sick of doing that. And you run into this all the time with real estate investors. Okay, I can't do this anymore. I can't mentally handle this aspect of owning real estate. So what are my options, right? Well, I could sell it, take a huge tax hit on the appreciation. Well, that stinks, right? What are some other options we could do? We could do a 1031 exchange, right? So we have that conversation. And what I'm giving you is a real life conversation with an actual airline client here. So this isn't made up or fabricated stuff. I want this gentleman to have real estate in his portfolio. I want to help him do that in a way that takes, again, behavioral caps on, takes the stress of owning real estate off of him, but still provides the benefits of owning real estate, right? So we talked through the situation. One of the things that we did for him also is, last year was a crazy year, right? The stock market was kind of a roller coaster ride in the short term. And what we did was we did some aggressive tax loss harvesting for him in his taxable account. So now this guy's walking away with a couple options, right? And there's no right or wrong answer to it necessarily. He could sell the real estate and have a capital gain, but we tax loss harvested $100,000 for him in losses last year that he can use to offset that gain if he wants. That's one option. He can do a 1031 exchange if he wants to stay in the real estate game and do that and now take the headache of owning that real estate off. Or third option, which nobody wants to do, is sell it and just eat the tax bill. So these are the kinds of problems we're helping folks solve. Real life airline pilots that are in these situations, could be you listening out there right now. These are the sorts of things that we're trying to help people out. And Ryan, I kind of wish that would have been somebody that maybe you had got to talk to, because our conversation here isn't, I want to turn you off from this one asset class. I want to help it work coherently within your situation.
Flight plan.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I don't know, Tate, if you've had similar encounters with, CFPs and CFAs and.
Yeah. In my personal experience, working with a number of financial advisors in sort of my previous life before I went really deep into real estate was basically, a reflection of Ryan, what you just said, where, you know, they really didn't understand it. They didn't get paid on it. And so it was like, you can do that all you want on your own time, but that's not what we're going to advise on or put you in. And I think it's really it's a shame, and it's a big, it's a glaring hole in the financial planning industry, for a lot of firms.
Absolutely agree. And that's why you got to ask those questions we talked about earlier that you kind of brought up, Tate, which is, how do you make your money? A lot of the places out there, again, a lot of these are household names, but they have a strategy that's ongoing, and you provide your hard-earned assets for them to invest, and they're just incorporating it in their strategy that they use on 1,000, for 1,000 other people. Right. And they're making money off of it and whatnot. The question you ask yourself is, are you going to create a strategy for me personally, right, as your client? Or, and if I have something that I want to incorporate in that, are you going to help me make that happen, like real estate? Or are you just going to kind of turn your head at me because what I'm telling you doesn't fit with your company line strategy here of you take my assets and you just put it in the pool with everyone else kind of thing. So now there are times and places to do that, similar to like what you gentlemen are doing, right? Where you manage a specific fund or you run a syndication sort of thing. And in that case, I think what's really important here too, just like with financial planning, is to have a relationship with the person that you're dealing with, right? So Ryan, I would guess, because you and I know each other and we've talked more about, I could speak more to like what I know about you, but I would imagine you guys have, and I've seen the outreach that you do a lot of relationship building, right? So it's not just, hey, we're going to ask people to trust us and invest with us, and then, okay, have a nice day. You have a lot of different offerings. You have a lot of different investor engagement where you are building a relationship with the people that work with you. And so that's really key too. If you work with somebody and you never hear from them, and you get the feeling they're just kind of throwing you in, you're just another cog in their machine, it's probably a good time to start asking yourself some questions like, hey, what's actually happening here? And maybe find somebody else who is willing to communicate with you a little bit better.
Jesse, I love that. You kind of touch on like a couple things that you do to kind of keep in touch with your clients. Is it more kind of mass touch reach outs, or do you do some kind of tailored? I love that kind of stuff. So
yeah, well, I tell you here, we have very, it's client engagement is what we track here. because there's so many people that are wrapped around the axle in this industry of AUM, assets under management, right? Oh, did last year assets under management went down. Why? Because the stock market went down. That's kind of a no-brainer explanation right there. And they get wrapped around the axle of that. What we really take pride here on our team is client engagement. That's what we track, which is, are you keeping in touch with your folks and just talking to them? That's also where the education piece comes in. That tax loss harvesting example I used earlier, when somebody comes here, I already have given them the expectation of what's going to happen inevitably. It's not an if, it's a when. Inevitably, when the next market downturn happens, 9/11 or 2008 crisis or Russia invades Ukraine, you can guarantee, there's not a whole lot of guarantees in this industry, as you guys know. You try to avoid the word guarantee, but one thing I guarantee is like, it shall happen again, right? It may be for different reasons, but it'll happen. The trick is not the trick really. The goal is to educate people so that when that does happen, they have a reasonable expectation of, okay, this is what's going to happen. This is what the person who works for me, and for all the listeners out there, don't forget that all the people in this room that do this kind of line of work, they work for you. You don't work for them. What are the people that work for me going to be doing during this time, and have a good understanding, a good education about what's going to happen? The education I would have with a client of the volatility that occurs in the short-term market would be, hey, You know, if you have a taxable account, we're going to look to aggressively tax loss harvest that to bring you a future tax benefit at some point in the future that you can use on down the line. Like the example of that guy that may sell some real estate. That is something that's an advantage he can use in the future. Or if he has a big taxable account someday, he can just live off of that and offset the tax bill for the rest of his life if he's done a good job, you know, basically accumulating losses that carry forward. So, and I know we're kind of going down this rabbit hole now, but I think you guys are asking all the right questions, which is you want to know that the person you're going to engage with, that they're willing to have a relationship with you and willing to engage with you. And that is very important about what we do here. So absolutely. As far as how we reach out and engage with people, you know, I look for any reason to reach out to people to let them know what's going on.
I encourage my team to, like, even if it's like tracking down a bank account or doing admin work, I'm like, that's an excuse. That's an excuse to call somebody.
Hey, how's it
going? And then even though I'm calling you on a very basic admin, you know, thing, it's a reason to touch base with a client, and, you know, and you might strike up a conversation and learn something about that client you didn't know about. So
exactly. Yeah. We had, I think everyone knows in the industry, Delta signed a new contract just recently. And that was kind of a game changer for those guys. So guys and gals, so all my Delta clients, you know, reached out, hey, how you feel about the new contract? I'm always careful to say what I think about it because, as you know, some people love the contract, some people hate it, right? I usually remain agnostic on that because, you know, in the end, it's not really my job to have an opinion on the contract. I have no control over that. And that's a whole different lesson that all the people out there should learn, which is, you know, control what you can control in your life and don't worry so much about what you can't control. But, you know, that's a great touch point, for instance. Hey, Delta folks, you know, you got a new contract. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about how this may affect your plan. Is this going to update how you contribute to certain things? Is this going to free up some extra capital to do some other things that you've been hoping to do? You know, great example. There was a talk of a second retirement plan for Delta folks that might be on the table that then suddenly wasn't on there. So, you know, we were kind of having the conversations with folks about, hey, if this does happen, you know, this is the pros and cons of it. These are the kind of the two different options for you. In the case of Delta, as everyone knows now in the industry, that didn't work out for them. That was not included in the new contract, but those are the kinds of things, reasons that we would reach out and talk to them.
Not to be opinionated. Thank God. I'm sorry. I was against it.
Let's hear it, Ryan.
Well, I mean, you know, that last little dribble of cash that I can't. I just want my cash, man. I can find out something. I can figure out what I need to do with it. Anyway, we don't have to go down that road. I'm glad it's there. Anyway, I'd rather give it to somebody like you to go manage. I not just get it stuck somewhere else, right? I'd rather go invest with a guy like Tate or put it in my own projects, right? So
that you have relationships with, and I can't emphasize enough that you don't want to be a cog in someone's machine. Develop and invest and trust people that are willing to have a relationship with you. And there's a lot of folks that are really savvy on this stuff on their own. I think a majority of our audience, and again, I keep referring to other podcasts here in your series, folks. Go listen to the previous ones. I became a fanboy here, so I'm promoting your podcast because I love it so much.
Thank you.
Absolutely. And I've listened and I learned a lot just listening to, especially on the real estate side. I think you can never quit learning, whether you're a personal investor or you're in this business. And listen to some people that do some very complex things that I personally would not have the time to do myself.
Yeah.
And so it's really good to, again, have that relationship with somebody. And if you want to get into some of these things, like the real estate, you know, investments, but you don't have the wherewithal to handle the headache of it, it's really good to have people you trust to help you, guide you through that. So
absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, Jesse, if people want to create a relationship with you and your firm, how do they find out more about creative planning?
Pretty easy to find me on LinkedIn, Jesse Reed, JesseReed. You can find me on LinkedIn, or you can send me an email, jesse.reed@creativeplanning.com. Two of the easiest ways to reach out to me. And like I said, responsiveness is what we do here. So we if you reach out to me, you'll hear back from me.
Awesome. Well, tell them you found out about them on Passive Income Pilots.
Yeah, there you go. You got like a 30% discount, right? No, I'm just joking.
Just kidding. No, I really do. I really do appreciate what you guys are doing. I love that somebody started a podcast that is geared towards pilots. and not just moaning about the contract or whatever on a particular airline, but actually talking about big picture things that are applicable.
Thanks, to, Jesse.
Not only everybody, but pilots. Yeah, no, I really appreciate what you guys doing, and I'm honored that you guys invited me. And had me blab here for about an hour.
You're good. No, you did a great job, and thanks for joining.
Thanks for joining. We'll catch you next time. Thanks, Jesse, for coming on.
Take care, guys. Appreciate it.
Take care.